Hello children, welcome to my class. I am Monika and today I am going to teach you the story The Address. Before I start with the chapter, I would like to give you a brief analysis of the life of the narrator, that is Marga Minkow. Now Marga Minkow was a Dutch journalist, right? She lived in Amsterdam and she also worked there. She was a Jew and suffered much under the Nazi rule in Holland. Her parents, her brother and her parents, all of them were arrested and they were sent to the Jewish quarter, and from there they were deported to the concentration camp, from where they never returned. Now, after that she however escaped being arrested, and later on she became a journalist. And she also wrote stories. Now this story under our discussion, The Address, tells us about the brutalities, not exactly the brutalities, it gives us a nostalgic description of the narrator. She has lost her mother in the war. Now the war referred to in this chapter is the Second World War, where the Nazis were defeated, where the Nazis have already been defeated, and Germany is under, Allied powers have taken control and situation is once again returning to normal. She talks about a time, what happens here in this story is, when the Nazis were actually trying to control the Jews or deport them, the narrator's mother, since she was also a Jew, she sent all her things, all her belongings, ancient belongings, to one of her old friend Mrs. Dolling. Actually, she didn't send. All of a sudden, Mrs. Dolling turned up and she suggested that she should save all the belongings and took everything away in turn. Right? Every time she would come, she would take away the things. The narrator saw this and she didn't actually like this thing. But then the mother convinced her, saying that anytime there might be a war, anytime they might be arrested and their things would all be taken away. Their things would all be damaged and destroyed. So it's better to give it to someone who can take care of those things. And after that, there was the war and the mother also died. The story opens from a place when the mother has already died. The war has already ended. The narrator now wants to get back her things. So she goes to the address which was once given to her, which was 46 Marconi Street, where the Dorlings live. She remembers the address and she goes there in order to get back her things. She wanted to get back the old things of her mother, right? Because it was agreed that Mrs. Dolling is going to keep the things safely. But she was not allowed to get in. Mrs. Dolling pretended. First of all, Mrs. Dolling pretended that she does not know her. Later, when she was not there, in her absence, the narrator, who has been introduced in the chapter as Mrs. S's daughter, we do not know her name for certain, neither do we know the name of her mother. The only thing we know about the narrator is that she is Mrs. S's daughter. And when the daughter returns, when Mrs. S's daughter, that is the protagonist of the chapter, when she goes for the second time, she was greeted and allowed inside the home by Mrs. Dolling's daughter. And on after going to the house, she found that all their things have been used by them in a very tasteless way, starting from the candle stand to the teapot to the tablecloth and the pewter plate, and everything was used by them, and all the things were used in a very distasteful way. The things were not managed carefully. So what she had thought that the things would all be taken care of was not at all done. And then she realizes that it's better to forget the address, to return, to leave that place and go. She realized that these things that belong to her mother would only give her pain, because the mother is no longer present. Mother is dead now. and these things will only give her discomfort and pain. So the first thing, she has to forget many things, and the first among them was that address, 46 Marconi Street, because that is the place where the narrator had all the things of her, all the belongings of her mother. So she decides to forget that address and walks away from the place. This is all about the story. Now we would read the story in detail. Now the story, the address. This short story is a poignant account of a daughter who goes in search of his mother's belongings after the war in Holland. When she finds them, the objects evoke memories of her earlier life. However, she decides to leave them all behind and resolves to move on. She decides to leave all those things and she decides to move on without paying heed much attention to those things. Do you still know me? I ask. Now, as I've told you, the story opens from the middle. We do not know what happened in the past, what had happened in the past, or where she is going, anything we do not know. Now, all of a sudden it begins with the girl knocking at the door and asking the owner of the house if she knows her. I asked. The woman looked at me searchingly. She had opened the door a chink. A chink means a very little. I came closer and stood on the step. No, I don't know you. I am Mrs. S's daughter. When the daughter refused to know her, denied to know her, she introduced herself as Mrs. S's daughter. And this is the only thing we know about the narrator in the whole story. She held her hand on the door as though she wanted to prevent it opening any further. Her face gave absolutely no sign of recognition. Now see, this is pretension. She very well knows who Mrs. S's daughter is, but she pretended as if she doesn't know. And she did not let the door to be open. She kept staring at me in silence. Perhaps I was mistaken. Now, the way she stared at her, it made the narrator think that perhaps she was mistaken. I thought, perhaps it isn't her. I had only seen her once, fleeting, and that was years ago. Now she remembered the past when she had seen her, and it was only once, that also a fleeting sight. Not a constant one, or not that she had been talking with that lady for a long time. It was just a fleeting sight when she was going away with all the things. It was most probable that I had rung the wrong bell. Now she thought that perhaps she had rung a wrong bell. The woman let go of the door and stepped to the side. She was wearing my mother's green knitted cardigan. Now when she stepped to the side, when more of her body was visible, the narrator saw that the woman was wearing her mother's green knitted cardigan. Its wooden buttons were rather pale from washing. She saw that I was looking at the cardigan. She realized that the narrator has very well recognized that the cardigan belonged to her mother. And then again, she half hid herself again behind the door. But I knew that I was right. She realized that she was right. She was not wrong. Well, you knew my mother? I asked. Have you come back? Said the woman. I thought that no one had come back. Now she said it, she admitted openly that she had thought that no one would ever come back and she would be using those things happily with none of its owner coming back to claim them. But she said that only me, she said here that it is only her, that is she was the only survivor of the war. Her parents were not there and she told her that it's only me, it's only her that had returned. I mean, who had returned now? A door opened and closed in the passage behind her. A musty smell emerged. Musty means damp. A damp kind of smell emerged, came out. I regret, I cannot do anything for you. She said that she regretted for not being able to do anything. I've come here specially on the train. I wanted to talk to you for a moment. She said that she had come there specially and she wanted to talk to her. It is not convenient for me now, said the woman. I can't see you another time. She said openly that it's not possible for her to talk to her then and she would speak sometimes later. She nodded and cautiously closed the door as though no one inside the house should be disturbed. Very cautiously she closed the door so that no one else inside the house might get disturbed. I stood where I was on the step. The curtain in front of the bay window moved. Someone stared at me and would then have asked what I wanted. Oh, nothing, the woman would have said said it was nothing. Now, this is what the narrator is thinking about. She says that perhaps even if someone stared at her, and even if someone asked the lady who she was, perhaps the lady would say that no one. Because somewhere in her mind she had realized that the lady has not told it to anyone, that these things, the things that they were using, did not belong to her. It belonged to someone else. She wanted to hide those facts from her family members. And that is why the narrator said that even if someone had asked her who had come, she would have said that it was no one. I looked at the nameplate again. Darling, it said, in black letters, on white enamel. And on the jamb, a bit higher, the number 46. As I walked slowly back to the station, I thought about my mother who had given me the address years ago. It had been in the first half of the war. Now, which war is she talking about? She's talking about the Second World War. It was during the first half of the Second World War that the mother had given this address. I was home for a few days and it struck me immediately that something or other about the rooms had changed. I missed various things. My mother was surprised. I should have noticed so quickly. So she had gone somewhere, and when she returned, then she had seen that many of the things of her house was missing. Because actually the things were taken over by Mrs. Darling, and she was very quick to notice those things. Then she told me about Mrs. Darling. I had never heard of her, but apparently she was an old acquaintance. Acquaintance means a person whom you know. Acquaintance of my mother, whom she hadn't seen for years. She had suddenly turned up and renewed their contact. Now she said that suddenly, all of a sudden, she had returned and she had renewed the contact. Since then, she had come regularly. Every time she leaves here, she takes something home with her, said my mother. She took all the silvers in one go, and then the antique plates that hung there. She had trouble lugging those large vases, and I'm worried. She got a crick on her back from the crockery. Now the mother said that she has taken all the table silver, that is the cutlery, in one go. And then she has also carried away the antique plates that hung there. And while taking the huge vases, she might get some crick. Crick means pain in her back. From the crockery. My mother shook her head pityingly. I would never have dared ask her. Now she said that she could have never dared to ask her to keep all the things in safe. But she had a deep trust in the goodness of, in the honesty of Mrs. Darling, and she said that she suggested it to me herself. She even insisted she wanted to save all my nice things. If we have to leave here, we shall lose everything, she says. Now she says that the mother said that if they ever need to go to any hiding, they had to leave all the things there. And in that case, they would be taken away by anyone, by any thief or anyone who would encroach into the room. So Mrs. Darling had offered to save all the nice things. Have you agreed with her that she should keep everything, I asked. As if that's necessary, my mother cried. It would simply be an insult to talk like that. And think about the risk she is running each time she goes out of the door with a full suitcase or bag. Now, when the daughter said that, have you agreed to let her keep all these things? The mother said that would be an insult to her. There's no need to ask anything. She just wanted to save the things, and that's it. And then she also said that she takes a lot of pain. She takes a lot of risk taking these things out. So she couldn't ask her. It would just be an insult. My mother seemed to notice that I was not entirely convinced. She looked at me reprovingly, and after that we spoke no more about it. So the daughter, that is Mrs. S's daughter, was not convinced by what Mrs. S said. And the mother looked at her reprovingly, and after that they never spoke about it. Meanwhile, I had arrived at the station. Now again, see, there is an oscillation in the past and the present. While standing at the door, while leaving the house of Mrs. Darling and all the way along to the station, she was thinking of all the things in the background. It was all in flashback, right? She was thinking what had happened in the past, how she came across Mrs. Darling, how Mrs. Darling came to take all their belongings. And now she is in the station, once again in the present. All these things were in the past. Now in the present, what is she saying? Meanwhile, I had arrived at the station without having paid much attention to the things on the way. I was walking in familiar places again for the first time since the war, but I did not want to go further than was necessary. I didn't want to upset myself with the sights of the streets and houses full of memories from a precious time. Now she says that she does not want to see much because those old bygone days are only going to produce sad memories. She's only going to be more nostalgic. She's only going to be more sad thinking about the days which has passed away. In the train back, I saw Mrs. Darling in front of me again, as I had the first time I met her. It was that morning after the day my mother had told me about her. I had got up late, and coming downstairs, I saw my mother about to see someone out, a woman with a broad back. Now, again, see in the past, the day she was going back, she saw Mrs. Darling again, right? In front of, not again, means for the first time she saw Mrs. Darling. And on that day she was supposed to go. And I had the first time, I meet her. It was the morning after the day my mother had told me about her. It was just the day before the mother had told about her. And she had got late, and when she came downstairs, she saw that her mother was about to see someone, a woman who had a very broad back. This is my daughter, said my mother. She beckoned to me. The woman nodded and picked up the suitcase under the rock coat rack. She wore a brown coat and a shapeless hat. Now she said that the mother was wearing a brown coat, and the lady who had come, she definitely was poor. Her dress, her appearance said that she was not a very rich lady. She was wearing a shapeless hat and a brown coat. Does she live far away? I asked, seeing the difficulty she had going out of the house with the heavy case. Now see, there is no one who would do, who would take so much of labor and so much of pain without any special interest or without any special purpose. The daughter was quick enough to understand this. Now she saw that the lady was going out with a very heavy suitcase. Now she asked whether she lived very far away. And the mother said, in Marconi Street, said my mother, number 46, remember that. I had remembered it, but I had waited a long time to go there. Initially, after the liberation, I was absolutely not interested in all that stored stuff. And naturally, I was also rather afraid of it. Afraid of being confronted with things that had belonged to a connection that no longer existed. Now, see this line. She said that she was afraid to get those things. Why? Because she was afraid to confront those things which were connected or which belonged to a person which no longer existed. That is the mother. So here we come to know that the mother, this is the second hint, second place where we get a hint that the mother is not here. Here it has been mentioned clearly that the mother is no longer alive. And in the first place, when she says only me, that is only her who has returned, there also we get the first hint. We got the first hint. Which were hidden away in cupboards and boxes and waiting in vain until they were put back in their place again, which had endured all those years because they were things. Now she thought that those things were locked up in some box or some bag. Perhaps they wanted to come out. They had endured those separation. They had endured to be locked because they were things. They couldn't speak out. But she was also afraid to confront those things which belonged to her mother, because the mother was no longer alive. But gradually, when things became normal, she decided one day that she's going to get all the things back again. But gradually, everything became normal, more normal again. Bread was getting to be lighter color. There was a bread you could sleep in unthreatened, a room with a view you were more used to glancing at each day. And one day I noticed I was curious about all the possession that must still be at that address. I wanted to see them, touch them, remember. After my first visit in vain to Mrs. Darling's house, I decided to try a second time. Now, a girl of about 15 opened the door to me. I asked her if her mother was at home. Now, she returned for the first day, and again, she decided to take a second try. And this time when she went there, she saw a girl of about 15 open the door to her. And when she asked if the mother was there, she said that the mother has gone to do some errand, means short work, a very small work. "No matter," I said, "I'll wait for her." I followed the girl along the passage. An old-fashioned iron Hanukkah candle holder hung next to the mirror. We never used it because it was much more cumbersome. Cumbersome means heavy. Now she said that they never used it because it was very heavy than a single candlestick. "Won't you sit down?" asked the girl. She held open the door of the living room and I went inside past her. I stopped horrified. She was horrified to see the way, the tasteless way in which all their costly things were kept. I was in a room I knew and did not know. Now she says that she was in a room she knew and again she did not know, because the things in the room belonged to her mother, but the room, the house itself, did not belong to them. So she said this. I found myself in the midst of the thing I did want to see again, but which oppressed me in this strange atmosphere. In this strange atmosphere, the sight of the things and the manner in which they were kept, it oppressed her. It didn't fill her mind with happiness. It was a kind of torture to see all those precious and costly things kept in such bad manner. Because of the ugly, or because of the tasteless way everything was arranged, because of the ugly furniture or the muggy smell, muggy means damp smell, that hung there. I don't know, but I scarcely dared to look around. The girl moved a chair. I sat down and stared at the wooden tablecloth. I rubbed it. My fingers grew warm from rubbing. She rubbed at the tablecloth. Why? Because she wanted to find out the burn mark. She knew that it belonged to them, but in order to become more sure, she rubbed her hand along the edge of the tablecloth. And she knew that somewhere along the edge, there would be a burnt mark. I followed the lines of the pattern. Somewhere on the edge, there should be a burn mark that had never been repaired. "My mother will be back soon," said the girl. "I have already made tea for her. Will you have a cup?" "Thank you." I looked up. The girl put cups ready on the tea table. She had a broad bag. Just like her mother, the girl also had a broad bag. She poured tea from the white pot. All it had was a golden border on the lid. I remembered. She opened a box and took some spoons out. Now they were using the tablecloth, they were using the teapot. The teapot had a golden border which had now become fainted. It had gone away. It had been, the color, the golden border had faded away. But she remembered there was a golden border there. She opened a box and took out some spoons. "That's a nice box, I heard my own voice. It was a strange voice, as though each sound was different in this room. "Oh, you know about them?" she said. "That's a nice voice. That's a nice box." She heard her own voice, but in this room the voice seemed to be different. "Oh, you know about them?" She had turned around and brought me my tea. She laughed. "My mother says it is antique. We have got lots more." She pointed around the room. "See for yourself." Now she said that the mother said that the box and its contents were all antiques, and she said that they have a lot of antiques in the house, and she asked the girl to look around the room to see the antiques. Now just imagine, she is showing the lady their own things which had been taken away by her mother and kept in their house, and she told everyone that those things belonged to them, which were all lies. I had no reason to follow her hand. I knew which things she meant. I just looked at the still life over the tea table. As a child, I had always fancied the apple on the pewter plate. "We use it for everything," she said. "Once we had even ate much of the plates hanging there on the wall." Just imagine how pathetic. She said that she had eaten her meal on the wall hanging. "I wanted to so much, but it wasn't anything special." Now she said she wanted to eat on it, but it was no special. "I had found the burn mark on the tablecloth." The girl looked questioningly at me. "Yes," I said. "You get so used to touching all these lovely things in the house, you hardly look at them anymore." You only notice when something is missing because it had to be repaired or because you have lent it, for example. Now, the lady say, Mrs. S's daughter said that you don't feel the importance of your thing when they are there. You start missing it because you have sent it for getting repaired, or perhaps you have lent it to someone. Now that this little girl of 15 years, she didn't know anything. So she didn't understand what the narrator meant by all these things. Again, I heard the unnatural sound of my voice and I went on. I remember my mother once asked me if I would help her polish the silver. It was a very long time ago and I was probably bored that day, or perhaps I had to stay at home because I was ill. As she had never asked me before, I asked her which silver she meant, and she replied, surprised, that it was the spoons, forks and knives, of course. And that was the strange thing. I didn't know the cutlery we ate of every day was silver. Now she again heard her strange voice. Actually, why did she say it was strange voice? Because she was actually saying these things in order to find out the truth. She said that in past, one day her mother had asked her, Mrs. S had asked her daughter to clean all the silvers. Now she was surprised and asked which silver she was talking about, and it was then that the mother had revealed that the cutlery they eat with, they were all made of silver. The girl laughed again. I bet you don't know it either. I looked intently at her. Now she said, Mrs. S's daughter said to the daughter that I can bet that even you don't know that you also eat with a silver cutlery, because she knew that they had been using their cutlery, which were made up of all silver. I bet you don't know it is either. I looked intently at her. What we eat with? She asked. Well, do you know? She hesitated. She walked to the sideboard and wanted to open a drawer. I'll look. It's in here. She said, wait, let me look. It's all the things are here. I jumped up. I was forgetting the time. I must catch my train. She had her hand on the drawer. Don't you want to wait for my mother? She was still holding the drawer. She wanted to take out the cutlery and find out if they were all silver or not. All of a sudden, the narrator said that she is going to go because it was time for her. She needed to catch the train. Now, the girl asked her if she didn't want to talk to the mother. No, I must go. I walked to the door. The girl pulled the drawer open. I can find my own way. The girl, while going, the narrator said that she could find her own way. As I walked down the passage, I heard the jingling of spoons and forks. At the corner of the road, I looked up at the nameplate. Marconi Street, it said. I had been at number 46. The address was correct. But now I didn't want to remember it anymore. Now she said that she knew that she had come to the right address, but now she didn't want to remember it. I wouldn't go back there because the objects that are linked in your memory with the familiar life of former times instantly lose their value when severed for them, cut away from them. You see them again in strange surrounding. Now she says that when the things that of your former times, when the things that are linked to your memory, they are cut away from your past, they immediately lose their importance. Especially when you see them in a strange surrounding, you find that they are very unfamiliar. And what should I have done with them in a small rented room where the shreds of blackout paper still hung along the window and no more than handful of cutlery fitted in the narrow table drawer? Now, there are two reasons for which she didn't want to take those things back. Firstly, because she didn't want to be nostalgic about her mother. She didn't want to remember, take those things away, because those things are going to make him remember about her mother. And secondly, she lives in a rented house, which is very small, and it would not hold so many things. Only a handful of cutlery would fit in the narrow table drawer. So she resolved. I resolved to forget the address. Of all the things I had to forget, that would be the easiest. She said the easiest thing to forget would be the address. And other than address, she also had to forget many other things. Because those things which are connected to her past will only give her sadness. So she resolved that she, along with the other things, she is also going to remember, forget the address. That's all about the chapter, children. Hope you enjoyed the lesson and you also understood the chapter. Thanks for attending the session. Goodbye.